Hey, what's up, guys? It's Ronaldo here, and welcome to the Sunday Debate. It is the 1st of July 2018, and your weekend is officially over. Now, first and foremost, I want to thank Yoliswa Yako for being on this live stream. Thank you so much for being here, Yoliswa.
Yay.
Thank you. Now, Yoliswa is a colleague of mine that, like, look, let's not beat around the bush. We are both counselors, and we are here on behalf of ourselves. So even though I'm part of the DA, this is not a DA thing. It's not an EFF thing, according to, you know, Yoliswa. So we are here to represent ourselves and discuss what's going on and speak on specific things that we would like to discuss, just either to get, you know, the sort of narrative out there that, you know, people from different political ideologies can have a discussion and still be civil with one another. So with that being said, Yoliswa, I'll give you a minute or two if you need that much, just to tell people who you are. And yeah, we can go from there.
Okay. Hi, everybody. This is the first time being live on YouTube. So I just see Ronaldo in my head. So anyway, I'm an EFF counselor. I'm also the impact chairperson, meaning that I am supposed to oversee what happens in the municipality in terms of the books and also what the DA does. And so it's a new space for me. It's a new space for most of us in the EFF because it's a new space for the EFF to be in governance. So I'm here literally as just a layman trying to speak her mind into what it is that young people think about. Exactly.
Perfect. Well, yeah, let me also first and foremost say that I really do respect Yoliswa. I think she is a powerful individual. She's a young leader that is very dynamic. So if any of you in the comment section, you know, even think of having a go at her, then it's completely against it's completely against what my impression of it is, even though she might form part of a political organization that I fundamentally disagree with. She's a lovely human being, and she is one of the few individuals in council that I consider a friend of mine. So with that being said, I think that'll be all the nice formalities out the way. I think we need to have a debate. So the three things that myself and Yoliswa will be discussing will be expropriation without compensation. It'll be whether land was stolen in the past in this country. And then the last thing will be whether or not black individuals can be racist in this country. So first and foremost, I'll hand over to you, Yoli, because I believe that obviously you understand the narrative and you understand what the point of it is, especially considering that, in my opinion, it's being led by Julius Malema. And I know you're not here to speak on behalf of the EFF, but it's something that is, I think, being implemented by the EFF. So just your personal opinion on it and whether you think it's right and why it is right.
Which part?
Well, land expropriation without compensation. So the basic element that the government should be in charge of the land and that the land should be taken away without compensation.
Well, I think, first of all, I think what I need to say is that when we talk about land as black people, and I'm talking black in terms of my skin color and the indigenous, you know, background of black people, it's a deep issue, and it's an issue that speaks to the dignity of what land represents to us, because you are born from South Africa, but you're not yet part of South Africa. So you cannot make definitive decisions onto where your path leads you to, which is why we've never been exposed to that for a greater part of our lives and our great-grandparents' lives, our grandparents' lives, our parents' lives, you know what I mean? So it's a deeper issue than just land. It's more of a dignity issue, an ownership issue, a belonging issue of what we are born from here, but we don't belong here. We don't feel like we belong here. But now, where I'm going to, in terms of the land expropriation without compensation, in terms of a layman's point of view, which I'm coming from, because, well, politics will speak, and you know how people know the narrative of what the politics are speaking. And I'm not coming from that because I don't think I am a politician. I'm more of an activist. But I think that when you talk about land expropriation without compensation, it speaks to give us back what belongs to us, give us back our dignity, give us back what makes sense to us, which is our rightful place in this country. And we don't feel like we truly rightfully belong here, because in everything that we do, we must make excuses, or we must apologize, or we must make space for other people to come before us before we can actually truly do what we want to do with it.
All right. So I hear what you're saying. And I mean, I can understand that, you know, due to the history of this country, there were elements where, you know, land was forcefully taken, and the people that the land belonged to, you know, was stolen. I can understand that. And I think that retribution needs to be taken place. But from what I've gathered from the policy as it stands now, the policy as it stands now, in essence, wants to give the government complete control of the land and basically make everybody in this land tenants. And you can answer that.
Yeah, I think what it says is that, from my understanding, and I always need to say this, that I'm not a politician, I'm an activist. And being an activist means that you're speaking on your behalf, you're speaking for your people. So you're speaking for your mother, your father, your children. You're not speaking for the broader perspective, but from a layman's point of view of what it is that you believe in. And I think when you speak about when the state owns the land, so it's not you giving it to the government, because I think the government represents something else to us. It represents the ANC. The ANC represents corruption. So people are like, we're not going to give it to the corrupt people who are going to just pillage and do what they want with it. So we want to give it to, we want to keep it. You know what I mean? We want to do what we want to do with it, but we want to give it to the state. The state is what governs what happens to the land. So the state is what will then say, what are you, Ronaldo, going to do with this land? Because we've got people that have land leases for 100 years. What are you going to do for, how are you going to control 100 years when you don't even, your lifespan is not even 100 years? So that's what we're talking about. We've got people that own expanse, like a lot of land. I mean, most of the land in South Africa belongs to private people. We don't even know. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
yeah, I know that the government owns a huge portion of the land.
It doesn't own a huge portion. It owns a small portion of the land, actually.
I think it was a third. I think it was a third the last time I checked.
Exactly. It owns a small portion of it. Like, most of the land belongs to private people, families.
But, yeah, I understand that. But I mean, look, I'm not here to say that, look, all the state land must be given, because that's where we need to start. But I do think that the state has failed miserably at, you know, righting the wrongs of the past and making sure that the people that are legitimately own land get their land back. So for me personally, I believe that this is an ANC fallback in order to blame everybody except themselves for not doing what they were supposed to do. Another question that I have for you, though, is, do you think that all the land was stolen or not?
All the land was stolen, because in 1652, these people arrived on our land and they say there was nobody here. And people have been living on this land. You cannot say in 1652, there was no human beings that were on this earth when they arrived. So there were people that were living in this country, and there were people that were profiting, and there were people that were trading, and there were people that were doing what they wanted to do with the land, and the land was taken from them. So you cannot say that there was no land or there was no people in the land for them. So our land was taken from us. And in some places, the land was taken forcefully. In some places, the land was taken diplomatically. In some spaces, the land was taken because there was no one there. So the land was taken from the rightful owners of the land, which was the inhabitants of the land at the time.
Yeah, look, I mean, that is where I'll probably disagree with you, because I think that even though, yes, I agree that there were some instances where land was forcibly taken. But I mean, if you look at the history of this country, when the Dutch arrived, you know, south of the or rather, what is it, east of the Fish River, there wasn't really interaction. I know that the Khoisan were there, but this is also now something that's taking place, as the Khoisan is arguing with the EFF, who's arguing with the other political parties about who the rightful owners of the land are. So I think there needs to be a clarity as to, when you say we, who you are referring to. Are you referring to the Khoisan people too? Or are you referring to Xhosa, Zulus, Venda, Sutus?
You've got to remember, Ronaldo, that history is subjective. It's who tells the history, remember?
Mm.
So the history that you know is history that's been told to you. So it's history that's been put in books. Who writes the books? In what language do they write the books? So it's history that's affiliated to you. It's history that you can assimilate, which is familiar to you. We're not told of the history that belongs to my people. Xhosa people were here. Xhosa is not a language that was made in just a second. Xhosa is not a language like Fanakaloa that was made in Johannesburg, where people had to just make way for themselves to speak to each other. Xhosa is a language. Nguni is a language. Zulu is a language. Shaka Zulu was there. Sotho is a language. You know, Setswana is a language. It's a language that's been there for hundreds of years, that people have affiliated themselves to speak the language. So you've got to understand that South Africa, in the modus that we are taught, I went to Victoria Park High School, and I chose history I chose to disassociate myself with history, and I chose science, because I was like, I don't understand this history. To me, I cannot assimilate it. I cannot understand the dates. I don't get it. Like, it doesn't make sense to me as a person. And even at the time, even though I did not know, maybe my consciousness was speaking to me, but I chose to not study history. I chose to rather talk about science, and chose maths, you know, something that I could figure out. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So when we talk about a history, you're talking about your history, history that's affiliated to you. But my history has not been taught to us. Our history has not been a history that makes sense to us, that we can affiliate with, that is we can be proud of, you know, a history that talks of triumph, you know, a history that talks of you know, all the good things that we've done in this earth. So that's why when we talk about history, I distance myself from it, because as I'm talking now as Yoli Soyago that literally joined politics in her 30s. It doesn't make sense to me, because it is not a history that I affiliate with, because it's subjective. It's not objective. It's not a history that's expansive. It's not a history that's inclusive of anybody. You know what I mean?
Yeah. The thing, though, is that, I mean, I can understand that the history that I was taught in school might have been like the, what is that saying? The history books are written by the victors, right?
Of course.
So I understand the argument that you have there, but I mean, then yeah. Again, you know, with all due respect, the it's now been almost three decades since the end of apartheid, and I mean, the ANC had the opportunity to write the history books according to what they feel happened, and I mean, I don't think we can deny the fact that most, you know, for especially the Xhosas and the Zulus came from West Africa. It's all a matter of when they arrived. So, I mean, if we're going to have the argument that the whole
of I'm going to disagree with you with the fact of from West Africa, because that's subjective. That is so subjective. And also, we're not here to discuss the history of Xhosa people and where they come from.
No, I agree.
Here to discuss the fact that in 1652, people arrived on this country, and they decided to do what they wanted to do with the land and how they wanted to do with the land. And now, how many hundreds of years later, we're dealing with the ramifications of what happened in 1652.
No, I understand, you know, that. But
now we're the generation that deals with that.
That's right. But I mean, look, I mean, there's been a lot of atrocities in the history of this of the world, right?
Definitely. So, I'm gonna ask you just for a second, because I want to go and sit somewhere where it's conducive for me to speak to you. Can you just give me one second?
Okay.
Just give me one second. I just need. Okay, but you can speak.
Okay. Yeah. So look, I mean, If we go along the lines of what has been fair and what has been unfair in the history of the world, I think everybody has suffered at the hands of one oppressor or another. Whether you be a white individual, an Indian, an Asian, a colored, a black individual, it doesn't really matter. The fact of the matter is it's called the zeitgeist. So You know, in 1652, when the white people, if you will, arrived in South Africa, it was that time. That is what took place. And I mean, in 1899, the Afrikaner nearly got wiped out by the British during the Anglo-Boer War. And that is just, it's part of history. It's like, can we judge, the people back in those days based on the mentality that we have today? So for instance, the land expropriation without compensation that's taking place today, is that fair to, the generations that came afterwards that paid tax on the land, that has paid and bought and has done what they needed to do in order to get the land?
I think so, Ronaldo, because first of all, you've got to understand the history of South Africa. As you've said, now we've had people that came in 1652 and they did what they did. Ultimately, we had the system of apartheid, which was a system. That system was harsh. That system was a harsh system, and it was a system. And it happened for many years. And our parents, we are still dealing with it in as much as we had to go to school with you guys. But still, we are affected by it because we don't have as much opportunity as you did because the ideology is still there. Even though it's long past, but it's still there. It's still underlying. It's still in the system, but it's just a little bit more sophisticated now. And when you talk about then... And then we had democracy. So democracy came into place. And so we were liberated, but we were liberated in a space where it was a liberation in the form that, okay, now you can vote. Now you've got just the bare minimum of space for you to operate, Now we're just giving you a leeway of how you can enter the spaces that you could not enter. So you can go into ShopRite without having to produce your dorm pass. You can literally go anywhere that you want to go to, but you don't have access to the economy. You don't have access to opportunities. You don't have access to education, proper education. You don't have access to a different way of thinking. You don't have access to much of the things that other people that have had the privilege of having access to are having. You know what I mean?
Yeah, look, I mean, I'm not going to argue with you on that fact, because as somebody that's a centrist, I fully understand the legacy of apartheid. I fully understand that.
I'm going to give you a lecture on the legacy of apartheid, but I'm trying to expose to you that, because you're saying now, here we are, and we've come from where we come from.
Yeah.
We've done all the things that we've said we're going to do. But now we want to bring this thing off the land. Now we want to talk about land. Now we want to talk about land expropriation without compensation and what informs that. And you've got to understand from a point of view of a person of my skin color, and this is what I'm trying to expose to you, is that it's deeper than just saying that, we're talking about giving our land back. It's more of a dignity issue, because we've got We have the democracy. We've been voting. I voted 4 times. Since 1994, I was 11, but I've voted about 4 times since then. And in that time, I'm voting for different things. But still, the system that is there, literally not allowing me access to where I want to be. It's literally not allowing me access to the economy. It's literally not allowing me access to the rightful kind of education that I'm looking for, that is going to afford me the opportunity to think outside of the space that I'm in now. Because obviously you liberate, right? And then after liberation, then you grow the economy. We've got countries that have done that, that have come out of obscurity and they've made something of themselves. So we're looking at growth in terms of as a people. So as a people, land in South Africa is a key requirement, because then we want ownership. And when we have ownership, we want to work the land. And when we work the land, we're going to then contribute towards generations which will better our people. Because our people have always been the people that are mostly at a disadvantage in South Africa.
But do you think this needs to, let me put it this way. Don't you think that the lack of land being owned by black individuals in South Africa today is mostly due to the government's failure instead of, innocent white individuals? And I mean, when I say innocent, I'm referring to the generation that we are currently living in, right? For instance, like I became a owner of land recently, like in the last 2 years. And look, if we're going to talk about white privilege and all that stuff, then I'm probably going to agree with you on most of those topics. But the issue that I have is that I think the failure of the government is being excused and it's being put onto white people as if white people are the evil individuals that are keeping land away from black people when it's not the case. And now we're going into a place where it's, well, we're going to take your land whether you like it or not.
I get that. I was speaking to a friend of mine actually just about 2 hours ago, and I was saying to her, the issue of land. I don't know how to put it in a way that makes sense, but I was saying that even when we're, I'm 35 now, and I'm going to be 40 in 5 years, I don't have a home now. I don't have a house that I own. And maybe at 40 or at 38, I will have a house that I own. And at 40, maybe the bill that speaks about land expropriation and optimization will take place or will kick in at that time. Now I would have bought a piece of land and say, now I can afford. Now I can afford to live in Mount Pleasant, and the state will say that land belongs to us, and I will, and then I must give it up after all the work that I've tried to put in trying to asset and to get that land. But it must happen because we are talking about a system. When democracy came into place, there were people that were saying, we don't need this democracy. We are happy with the status quo. We are fine with the way things are. We are fine to live with black people in our spaces. But at the same time, there has to be a system. There has to be a system that makes sure that everybody is allocated space to have equal opportunity to have access to the needs that they need to have. So, and I was saying to my friend, look, now you're going to be 40. And let's say at that time you've done all the things that you wanted to do, and you can buy a house. And the land and the state will say, look, that space belongs to us. You must give it up. You have to. You must subject yourself to the system that is there at the time because it's for the greater good of the country. And as a black person, you need to understand, especially as a black person, because you understand that your mother had to go through a different kind of system. Your grandparents had to go through a different kind of system, and therefore you must subject yourself to this system that is going to make sure that generationally your children and your children's children will have access to opportunity that is equal. So that means that no person that's created is a state. The state provides for all, which is why we need to have a state that is that has enough capacity to provide for all, and a state that has that is accountable and is for all, that is unbiased, that is without corruption, that can then give to all who live in it.
So let me give you the issues that I have currently with the land expropriation without compensation. So from my understanding of the policy, it's not going to affect only white people. And I think you alluded to the fact too, it's going to affect black people, especially middle class black people in this country that acquired land on their own, right?
It's going to affect our chiefs in the rural Eastern Cape, because that's what I know. So when we say that we want like all land, all South Africa's land must be expropriated without compensation. That means all. So that means even if you're a chief, even if you are a king, even if you are a whatever, all that land then belongs to the state.
But do you trust the state with the land?
This is what I'm saying. You keep the state accountable. This is why we need to have a proper democracy in this country that allows for us to keep the state accountable.
But that we already trust the state currently with so many things that they're not being held accountable. I think
said before we went to before we had democracy, we had a state, and that state was doing what it wanted to do. And now we then the ANC came in into power, and we had to trust that they had our best interest at heart. And unfortunately, some of them within the ANC did not have our best interest at heart. And that is why you need to have an effective opposition that makes sure that it seeks to push the needs of the people. So you as the DA are in opposition in terms of the national structure. You know, I'm not talking about this in the day, but in terms of the national structure, you are as an opposition are pushing to see that the needs of the people are met. Us as the EFF, we're pushing for the needs of the people to be met. So in every space, you need to push the narrative that actually what we are doing is to try and see that the needs of the state are met. But ultimately, dignity must be brought to the people that rightfully belong to this land, people that have been pushed out of this land. The majority of this land are black people. Majority in South Africa are black people, and they are the most dispossessed. And I'm not talking now after democracy, I'm talking previously, you know, during the apartheid era. Previously in 1652, that's what happened. It's been generations of us being subjected to a narrative that seeks to put us last, a narrative that seeks to put us at the worst of spaces, that we are the least, we are the most marginalized of people, and we don't belong anywhere. Yet we were born here, our ancestors are from here, you know. So why can't we have access to all that we want to be, or why can't we have access to all that needs to belong to us, you know? Why can't we be afforded an opportunity to see what we can do with our land, the land that belongs to us?
Yeah, look, like I said, if we're going to talk legacy, I'm going to agree with you on a lot of what you have to say. However, the difference is, I think that as bad as apartheid was, and there was nothing positive about it, the legacy of apartheid needs to eventually end somewhere. And the responsibility of the ANC government needs to be on the other end of it. And I think what's happening currently is that the ANC and its government is completely being excused from all accountability, and it's all just the legacy of apartheid that's blamed for everything that's wrong in this country.
I disagree with you. I agree with you, and I disagree. I agree with you on the part that... I agree with you on the part that, you know, the ANC needs to take responsibility because now it is governing. And that's the main part in that, you know, when you liberate a people, when you are a liberation party and you liberate people and you say, I've liberated you, then you need to find a strategy to then move yourself from being a liberation party and then move yourself to being, okay, now what do we do? How do we restructure ourselves as a party that seeks to then renew this democracy that we've now found? And I think maybe in Africa is where we've kind of lost ourselves, in that we liberate our people and then we don't know. Then we sit with the money, and then people, a certain kind of people, then come and then they just spend money, and it goes to a certain minority of people, not to a lot of people, because that party then cannot remold itself and cannot restructure itself to the needs of the people now, because needs change. Firstly, we needed to change into a democracy because we could not have access to a great many things that we could not get, like education, taking our children to certain schools, living in certain places.
Going, no, I agree with you there.
You know what I mean? Like, so, but after that, you need to then change and say, look, now we're here. So how do we then change? And say, now we want to then start educating our people. We want to then have better healthcare for our people. We want to then have sanitation. We want to have our people to have access to whatever they want to have access to, whatever our people want to do. But that's not what the ANC is doing. The ANC is not doing that. It's literally remained as that Liberation Party, and people must just vote for it because it liberated us, and here we are because of the ANC. And that's where I think it has failed.
I think we both can agree that the ANC was an amazing liberalization organization, but absolutely terrible government.
No, it did, but in governance, it's literally proven itself that it's not able to govern.
Well, here's a question. How do you feel about the Ramaphosa administration?
I think it's smoke and scream. I think it's mainly
same old,
but I think that it's like me going to your house, you know what I mean? For instance, I go to your house, I can speak like you speak. I'm more acceptable to you because now I can, you know what I mean? Like, you've got somebody that doesn't speak like, oh, I come from Africa, so now you must accommodate me, and now your perception of me is that I'm primitive and whatnot, you know what I mean?
Well, I don't hope you mean me.
I'm not talking about you, but I'm talking like in a narrative, you know what I mean?
Okay, I hear what you're saying.
Obviously, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking in the narrative of, like, you know, if I were to speak differently, then you would be like, I'll come to your house and be like, oh, I want water. I'm not speaking in a way that you speak in. But now, because I speak maybe possibly how you speak, or I sort of approach things how you approach things, they are more acceptable to you, even though I'm different to you, but I'm more acceptable, but I'm still different. But I'm also still not helping my people. And I don't think he's doing a lot. In fact, he's not doing anything to help his people at all.
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean, obviously the legacy of Zuma is still here because, I mean, you can't blame Ramaphosa for everything that's currently gone up. But with that said, I mean, you should have seen an improvement on some aspect, at least for something else. And that's just not taken place.
Yeah, I think that Zuma came at it in a very raw manner, which I also think is I don't know how to say it, but I don't think there's any difference between Zuma and Ramaphosa except for how they appeal to white monopoly capital. And unfortunately, white monopoly capital is a word that's been used everywhere. It's like, you, Ronaldo, are white monopoly capital. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I talk about white monopoly capital. Like, you are white monopoly capital. But the thing is that it appeals on a deeper level to the reason why our people, I'm talking about my people as a black person, are not progressing in South Africa. And Cyril Ramaphosa is not going to do anything, I believe. He just appeals. He's just okay to welcome in the house. He's just okay to assimilate. He's just okay when he talks. We can hear him because he appeals to us.
But do you think he's Uncle Tom then?
I don't want to say it.
Okay, well, I'm not trying to be like weird. You don't have to. I'm not trying to put, but I mean, from like,
I don't want to say it. I don't want to say it, but I think everything I've said just says like he literally appeals. Like, I would appeal in your house opposite a person that lives in another place, that's grown up in another place, that's black like me. We're all the same. In fact, we are the same people, but he's literally not doing anything different from the previous government or the previous administration in the ANC in terms of trying to advance the needs of the black people. It's okay for me to speak about the narrative of black people that are disadvantaged or that are, at a bad place. But what am I doing? What place, what stances have I took? And I think also it comes from a place of fear because he's spoken about land expropriation without compensation, but really what has happened in the way of government making sure that it's serious about land expropriation without compensation, you know? Is it serious about land occupation with the conversation? Are we serious about free education for all? No.
The thing is, I think the longer it takes, the better it will be for the EFF, because I honestly believe that, and I mean, the reason I say the EFF is because they're pushing the narrative. I think that the EFF has got, I think the EFF in reality understands that they won't govern within the next 10 years, in my opinion, if ever. So if the EFF is honestly like thinking that they can trust the ANC with land expropriation without compensation, then I think that it's going to cost them more votes than anything.
Because I don't think it's about trusting the ANC, to be honest with you. Had you been in government as the DA, we would push the same narrative and would push whoever is governing in terms of who's ruling, who's able, who's the administration. So it's not about us supporting the ANC, no. It is about us pushing their narrative, because remember, these are policies that were started by the ANC, but the ANC could not fulfill them because they got greedy. They became self-centered, and they took things and became personal, and they only gave to certain people. So
well, they've stolen over ₱1 trillion.
Do you understand? So we want to make sure that the people have everything. So what we're saying is, even if it was the DA that was in government, we would still push for land, because we've got 7 cardinal pillars as the EFF, and we want to push for our first cardinal pillar, which is land expropriation without compensation. So that is not even a debate for us. We want to make sure that there is land expropriation for equal redistribution to all, you know, without compensation. So there's no need for us to pay back to people what was stolen from us, which is what we believe.
But do you think, okay, I actually want to go back to a point you made about white monopoly capital. I mean, is that still a narrative that the EFF is pushing, considering that it came out that the Guptas were the ones that were hiding behind that?
No. The Guptas, yes, did run. They tried to capture the state. But if you go to actual capital, if you go to the banks, if you go to mines, if you go to all the strategic sectors in the economy in South Africa, they are run by white monopoly capital. It's white people that benefit, it's white families that benefit, it's white capital that benefits from that. Be it white capital that lives in South Africa, be it white capital that lives overseas, it is white capital that benefits from the economy of South Africa and not us.
And do you feel the same way about the media? Do you think the media is also white controlled?
I mean, everything is controlled by those who have power. Who has power?
Well, the ANC is in charge of the country, with all due respect.
I'm over you. No.
No, but I mean, it's an honest... The thing is, I can understand that there's this narrative that needs to be created... that it's the whites that's still evil. I mean, this
no,
just comes back to my point.
It's
not really the truth. I mean, if you look at the who owns, if we look at who, I mean, you just need to look at the adverts in South Africa. If you look at the adverts in this country, you can see who they are targeting, and they are targeting people with money.
What are they selling? What are they selling?
But listen, if you watched TV 10 years ago, you would see that Woolworths were targeting white individuals. SAB were targeting white individuals. All the big companies were targeting white individuals. Now, if you switch on your TV, you can see that that has completely changed. But the black middle class in this country, I think, has got more wealth than the majority of people in this country. Yes, there are still your Oppenheimers, and there are still your handful of people that's got billions and billions of rands. But don't forget that Cyril Ramaphosa falls into that category too.
No, I think when you talk about black middle class, you're talking about... South Africa does not have a black middle class that actually works, that is actually self-sustaining in terms of the economy, or that contributes to the economy. That black middle class.
When last have you been to Johannesburg or Cape Town?
No, I've been there. I've lived in Johannesburg. I've lived there for a long time. And in Johannesburg, literally, people are living off debt. So we want to appear, because we so want to We saw
Well, guess
want
what?
to
White people also
have all the
did.
things. No, we so want to have all the things that we've never had before. And it's a premature feeling, but it's a feeling that we need to, we want to have it, and there's nothing wrong with it also. But also we're not contributing to the bigger spectrum of the economy of this country. The people that have monopoly. Monopoly means that you literally have, you own everything. You have control over what people think, of what people say, of what people buy. It's white people, it's not black people. There's no black person that you know. Patrice Motsepe is a 1%, it's a minute, not even a 0.01% of a black people that actually have capital to do anything worthwhile. We don't have opportunities. But the thing is, we cannot expect also to have that much opportunity this
But
far.
don't you think, with that being said, with all due respect, though, I think if you look at let's argue that white monopoly capital exists, right? Do you want to tell me that white monopoly capital has more influence and power and money than the government in this
Yes.
country?
Yes, it does.
There's no way that
There is a
that even
way.
if it there isn't. There's no way. If you look at Eskom,
No.
if you look
What
at the board.
exists? No, Ronaldo.
But it is. I'm giving you.
No. No. I think maybe if you take out the white monopoly capital and maybe put a different word to it would not maybe be as, oh, it wouldn't run away from the facts, I want to say. Because if I mean, people, investors are foreign investors. Cape Town, where the money's at, is foreign investors. The private land that's owned. Oh, like it's literally, we don't have access as South Africans because most of the power has been given to foreign people to run. And I'm talking foreign people, even people that were born here, they don't have any kind of affiliation with South Africa. It's mainly just the money. They have no investment in making sure that this country thrives and this country grows and their people grow. They don't care as long as we're making money because the minerals are here. We've got gold, we've got diamonds, we've got the ocean, we've got all the things that could make this country literally profitable for all, but only a minority has access, like to the true, like proper profit of what we can gain from it. And our people are not getting anything from it.
Well, I don't know. I think when you say our people, I think that, look, for instance, if you look at affirmative action and broad-based black economic empowerment, that those policies have failed miserably because it's made a few people billionaires, and the majority of people have not benefited from that, the people that were supposed to benefit from it. But with that being said, when white monopoly capital is used, and I know that you use the term, and that's not your main argument, but my point is that I think that there are a bunch of black individuals that became multi-billionaires that have also excluded the majority of people in this country. So it's easy to point a finger and say, hey, but it's that white monopoly capital's over there. But yet the guys that are black individuals that are also billionaires from the mining industry and from all the other industries that have played this game to perfection, where they also exclude people, your average South African from
I
making
get
a
you.
living.
No, I get you. I get you. I get you completely. And that is also, I think as a reason why you need to have young parties like the EFF who expose, because remember, most of the policies or the pillars of the EFF in the founding manifesto and also in the elections manifesto, speak to policies that were formed by the ANC. So we have a liberation party that came in and they had all these policies and they had a youth wing that would speak these things because we could see that, we're going to liberate our people, yes. But then what are we going to do from when we have the land? What are you going to do? What are you going to do when you have state capture? What are you going to do when you've liber democracy has been had? All the things that you wanted to have, you've had it now. So what are you going to do? There needs to be a next step. But now
this is what I'm saying to you, is that what the ANC has failed to do is to move from where they say we've liberated our people. Now what are we going to do? And they've failed completely. They've not been able to think beyond the secluded few that were there, and the camaraderie, because they want to remain in power. Those few, I'm not talking about the ANC, I'm talking about leadership in the ANC that has wanted to remain in power and therefore have kept the state as it is now. And it's sad for us because 24 years now later, since 1994, where are we now? 24 years.
Yeah.
24 years later, we're not seeing change. Yes, we can vote, but what is that vote affording us? Yes, we can go into town, but what can I buy? Yes, we can go to universities, but I mean, before I go to university, the kind of education that I'm getting in my township school is not affording me an opportunity for me to be on par with you. Do you know what I mean? I'm not able to think as you do. So this is where they fail.
Hey, let's be real. Your salary is a bit more than mine, eh?
No, we're not there now. We're not there
now. Oh, we're avoiding that
one. We're not there now.
Okay, but listen. Let me... I get what you're saying, that we need young parties and stuff like that, right? But here's the thing. The EFF, Julius Malema, you know, he's my favorite individual out there. The EFF comes out, and or more specifically Julius Malema, and talks all this narrative of hate, in the sense that, you know, the EFF and Julius Malema wants to put out this target, and this target is white individuals. So the problem that I have is, if the EFF came out and said, listen, guys, the ANC is the biggest problem in this country, and this is how we're going to fix it, and without the narrative of trying to make white people sound like the absolute, you know, toxic cancer and the negative things, then I would say, you know, maybe it's good. A change is good. But when the individual that is representing the EFF comes out and says that we're going to slit the throat of whiteness, whether it's a figurative of speech or whether whatever, the point comes across that it's something that's insulting to me as a white individual, mm-hmm. and something that divides us as a nation.
I think maybe I need to correct you in some spaces, because you need to, it's going to be uncomfortable. However, you need to know that you are benefiting by virtue of the skin color that you have from every opportunity that I am not having access to. So it's not me attacking you, but it's me exposing the fact that as a black person, I'm not able to have access to most of the opportunities that you have. And we're not going to attack the ANC, but we're going to attack a system. There's now a change of system. There's a system that was there before, which was of apartheid, but there's a new economic system that we have now. Remember, I'm going to say this. Do you know why I joined the EFF? Literally, when I joined the EFF, I was an ordinary person just literally working. And I thought to myself, I'm just Yoli. And everybody's like, how you talk to me, Yoli, Yoli, Yoli. And I appeal to everybody. I appeal to black people, I appeal to white people. So there's no difference between me and everybody else. Until I worked in the private sector, until I was employed in the private sector, until it was literally open to my eyes that, you know, actually, we're only employing you because we need a BEE scorecard. Because there's a new way now to try to assimilate black people into the structures, to assimilate black people into the private sector, assimilate black people into the economic structures of the country. So we need to have black people in this company. So you're only here for that. And I could see that the guy that was employed with me, first of all, did not have as much experience as I had, did not work as hard as I did, but was close to the boss more than I was. He could smoke with the bosses, and he got a better salary than me. And I found out that he was earning a much better, you know, salary than me. And I was like, I can't understand how this could be, that because of my skin color, had I been white, Ronaldo, I would have been far in my life right now. I'm telling you now. And as much as I went to the same schools as you did, I'm not afforded the same opportunities as you have, because there's no way that my country protects me as a person who's not the same skin color as you, as an indigenous person of this country,
you know, to be afforded the same space that you are afforded. And it's just how the system is. And at times you need to write the system in whatever way that you can. So we're going to start to talk about the land, because land is one of the pivotal spaces that we must first enter. We want to have access to all the land in this country so that we can do what we want with the land, but that we must be accountable to the state. So it doesn't mean that we're going to just take the land and do what we want to do with it and run amok and just do and be crazy and be crazy people and just go and, you know what I mean, like just kill people and do whatever. But we want to plow the land and do what we want to do with the land because we have the skills, but we are not afforded opportunities just like everybody else.
The thing is, look, let me answer this in two ways, right? Using you and me as an example, because we're the same age, right? Now, up until, I would say, the age of about 2021, I will completely agree with you that you weren't afforded the same opportunity as me based on the color of your skin, right? And that goes back even to things like white privilege, where, for example, I had a vehicle that I could go to university with when maybe you had to use a taxi. I don't know. But on average, there are these subtle things that gave me a benefit over you in being more successful in life, right? However, where I have to completely disagree with you is the fact that as it stands right now in South Africa, you, on average, because you are firstly a female and secondly because you are black, have far more opportunities that are available to you than to me as a white man. I think that's where you got it wrong. It's not. You just need to look at the job application.
No, Ronaldo, it's a perception, because on paper, do you understand how the system works?
I do, yeah.
On paper, it looks like you've got more opportunities than I do. I'm being here oppressed as a white man. I can get a job. You're going to get a job before me. But
I'm not saying I'm oppressed. I'm saying you've got more opportunities than I have.
I do not have more opportunity than you. This system has been there for generations. The system of, I'm talking about apartheid, and we've passed apartheid. We're gone now. Now we are on a more sophisticated system, which is an economic system. It's an economic system. That means how I live, the lifestyle that I have, my mindset, how society is based. Society, the reason why there's a breakdown in the difference in society in how I bring up my children from how you bring up your children is so different based on the economic situations that we're in. Do you understand?
Yeah, I do understand.
And it's much deeper for me, because if you suppress me economically, that means you suppress me psychologically, because I cannot function if I need to think where my money is coming from next time. I cannot function if I need to think that I cannot have access to jobs. I cannot have access to a house. I can access, even when I have a house, it's not decent. It's you know, are we allowed to swear?
Of course.
It's a shit shack. You know what I mean? Like, you live in a shit shack, and
is that the best? Why not a fuck shack is something different.
I was about to go there, but
a fuck shack is something different.
When your people come at me, and then I will like, yeah, no, you're talking shit right now.
Yeah.
So I'm saying that in as much as it appears as if I should be in a better space as a black woman, no. It's patronizing, which is where I'm coming from. It is patronizing because economically it does not translate. So I am employed in the company. I'm the face of the company. But you, Ronaldo, who is literally next to me, are earning a better salary. You are exposed to a lot more. And you do not have to work as hard as you did to get where I am. So it's tiring. It's sad. And it's literally dehumanizing for me to have to prove myself to the company that I'm actually worth it. I'm not just talking like you. I'm not just a pretty face. I'm not just, you know, a lot of things that you don't have to prove. So look, this is why I'm saying that dignity, it's about dignity. And you don't understand dignity because you've never had to fight for dignity, because you had it.
But that's the thing. I have to, like, I've found out, I mean, I've realized that over the senior part of my life, I've had to fight for my dignity in order to show that I understand. Because there's this massive brush that's just painted across white people across this country, in which every white person's assumed that they don't understand the legacy and the history and white privilege and all of these things.
Yeah.
So that is also, you know, that's one of the things of being a centrist, is you either looked at as a race traitor by your race if you're a white individual, and then, sorry to say, but if you then compare it to the EFF, then I'm also a demon and a poison because I'm a white individual, and that is the problem that I have.
But I think perhaps you don't understand the EFF, and I think most white people don't understand the EFF.
But the EFF, the individuals can only go on what they firstly hear coming out of the leadership's mouth. And what they hear coming out of the leadership's mouth is that you are not welcome here, firstly. And there's this constant, like, sort of subtle, not even subtle, it's blatant.
Kind of thing.
Yeah, the blatant fact that, you know, you are not welcome here, and the blatant fact that we're coming for you, and the blatant fact that, you know, if you don't agree with us, we're going to do something. You know, and that is what we get.
What so do you think we're going to do?
Well, I'm not saying you as in a collective. I'm saying what I'm hearing from your commander in chief, Julius Malema. Well, he said he's going to slit the throat of whiteness. He's saying kill the Boers so many times. And the general statements when he makes white people this, Indian people that, he said that more than, 51% of Indian people are racist. I mean,
yeah.
What did you just make that statement?
They are. More than
how can you statistically prove
I'm
that?
Not there to defend that, but they are, and I'm not gonna go beyond that, but they are. I've been in Durban, I've been around Indian people, I've been around Indian people in Johannesburg, and it is what it is, and I'm not going to defend it, I'm not going to explain it. It is what it is. And when you speak the truth, people will not accept the truth that you speak. And Julius Malema, the thing about him is that what people don't understand is that we're not blindly following a leader as if it's a cult following. We're literally, remember my history of what I'm telling you, where I come from. I come from a narrative of where I thought that I was equal to everybody until it was exposed to me that I'm not. And this person speaks a truth of what is a reality for Black people. And once you start to speak of a reality that is against what you think it is, you start to then be affronted by it. You start to become, oh, wow, then you're saying that I'm racist? No, Ronaldo, I'm not saying that you're racist. I've never said you're racist. You're my friend. You know this. But at the same time, you need to be exposed to what I'm going through. And this is what our people don't want to understand in South Africa. We're so busy catching feelings over things and narratives that we're not understanding what the other person is going through. Because I'm comfortable in my space. So I'm going to be like, oh, wow, Yoli can talk to Candace. Yoli has Janine as a friend. Yoli has Sarah as her best friend. She sleeps over and whatnot. So she's fine, and which is where I was coming from before that. Until I was confronted with the reality that, no, you're Black. And when I look at you, you're still Black. And when my children are born, and I've got two sons, and then they walk the earth in 20 years to come, when they get jobs, they will always be Black. And Black in this country is negative. Black in this country means you have to work a little bit extra just to prove yourself. You have to talk a little bit softer just to prove that you're not like other people. And people disregard your opinion. People put you in places because you are Black and you're a woman. I don't need to be put in places because I'm Black and I'm a woman. I need to be put in places because I'm competent. You know what I mean? But yeah, the system is how it is.
So there's two things, right? The okay. First thing with regards to what you said with Indian individuals is, like, I get the point that there are racist people all across this country. There are Black racists, white racists. And maybe we can leave and go into that point because it's already 9 o'clock.
You and I who live in PE can live the narrative of Indian people who oppress who oppress Black people out of this conversation, because we're not exposed to it as much as people that live in KZN. And
no, I get that, but you can't say 51%. So you
said it, and I agree with you. I actually agree with Julius Malema. They are. they
Okay,
are
but I
racist.
didn't say that. Malema said that.
No, yes, and I agree with him because I've been exposed to it.
But
I've been
51%,
exposed.
that's such a random, like, so you're saying majority of Indian people, not
Majority,
you.
I'm saying it with him, that majority of Indian people in this country look down on black people. Majority of black people in this country oppress black people. Majority of Indian people in this country
I don't
don't look
know.
at
Like,
black people as equal.
I'll be honest. Like,
Majority
I
of
see that
black
as
of
such a
Indian
shocking
people,
statement, though.
majority, no, majority of Indian people in this country do not identify themselves as black. They identify themselves as people of color because they don't want to be associated with anything that is black, which is us. And they are oppressed as much as we are, but they don't want to because they think they are better than us.
But to the second part, then, don't you think that Malema and the EFF is giving way too much credit for this psychological issue that black individuals have amongst themselves by thinking that they're inferior, by trying to say that it's a narrative that's created by white people? Because black people in this country is the overwhelming majority of the population.
But
So
how does that
constantly.
majority work for us, Ronaldo? We've been in the party for hundreds of years. Like, we've been oppressed for hundreds of years. How does that majority, we would like flipping people, that most people that live here in South Africa, but look where we were. It took Nelson Mandela to walk in 1990 for us to literally be like, oh, yay, we've got a little bit of power. And we don't even have power. So we don't have power. And that's why we need. Even Steve Biko, when he was talking about black consciousness, he had to talk about black consciousness. He had to talk about you have to believe in yourself as a black. He had to affirm what we were because we were so broken as a people because of a system that a minority put over us. And that's how broken we are. You know, when you enslave people mentally, you take away, you strip away everything that is theirs. You take away whatever it is that they think they are. So we are rebuilding right now our own consciousness to say, no, we want the land. We want it, and we want it, and we want it without compensation. We don't have to compensate you for taking our land in 1652 and taking and killing our people for you to get the land or tricking our people to get the land. No, we're not going to make apologies for
But
that. We want it.
isn't that sort of realization and empowerment at the cost of innocent people out there?
Oh,
I mean, innocent white individuals and
are you
innocent.
innocent? Are you innocent?
Well, I believe that I didn't directly have a hand in it. I understand that I.
You're enjoying
Let
the
me
privilege.
finish. Let me finish. Look, I mean, yeah, look, if
Okay.
you had to have a discussion with a right individual, I mean, I think that this would have gone a lot different. I understand my privilege. I understand my privilege, right? First and foremost. However, I do think that even with, I think that the narrative that the EFF has, the way that they're going out about it, is they're even losing the centrists out there that would say, listen, I can understand where they're coming from. But making enemies out of people that honestly shouldn't be blamed for something. I mean, as much as I'm a
Ronaldo,
beneficiary, wait
I
now,
hear
as much
you.
as I, no, wait, but as much as I'm a beneficiary of the legacy of apartheid, right? I didn't physically directly control apartheid. What I can do is I can acknowledge my privilege and I can fight to improve other individuals' standing in this country, as I'm doing as a politician in South Africa, right? But to be painted and labeled and insulted by a leader of an opposition party and said that, you know, we're going to deal with all of you. I think that's very, very unfair.
I think you're being sensitive about it, to be honest, and I think that you are subjecting yourself to it. However, as in apartheid, I'm gonna bring apartheid because it is. I mean, what the EFF is saying now is nothing compared to what our parents went through, and you would never understand because you never lived through it. And I'm talking. I never lived through apartheid. I was born in 1983. But my mother is a byproduct of it. How she thinks, how she brought me up, how she taught me, how whatever it is that she put in my mind is as a result of her brain being subdued by the system of apartheid, which her parents were brought up and subdued by the system of apartheid, you would never understand, because you are brought to think freely and you are brought to think how you want to think, and you don't understand. When we say that we are unapologetic, and we need to be unapologetic right now, because we want to think for our children. I'm going to think for Kabiso and Zino right now, because I need to, because they are 10 and 6 years old, and in 20 years' time, they're going to be a contributing members of the economy of this country. So when I try and impart and move for change in this country, I'm thinking for them. I'm thinking that I need to be unapologetic, and I need to make sure that there are policies in place and there are changes in place in this country and the amendments in the constitutions of this country that make sure they have access to everything, because they don't have access to everything. They don't have access to economy. They don't have access to the right for education. I have to work extra hard just to get a job. I have to go into politics just to get a little bit of an extra paying job as an MPEC chairperson in the Nelson Mandela Bay municipality, just for me to be able to just do a little bit for them to just make a little bit of headway, which you don't have to.
Yeah, that you see, that's where I'll disagree with you, because if you and I had to go to, let's say, the top 20 companies in this country, and you and I had to apply for the same job today,
no, you're wrong.
You will get that job.
I will get the job, but I'm telling you now, there's a John.
Yes, but I'm not that John. I'm not that John.
Ronaldo. You may not be the John, but there's many Johns. There's many Marks. There's many Lukes. There's many flippin' Christophers that are there.
I so badly want to use my black stereotypical names too, but I don't want to walk into that trap.
Don't.
Okay, we can go on and on about this. And I think we had a good debate. Look, I mean, like, we are still poles apart, but I think the point of this was just to get it for the viewers out there, so that they can understand maybe what your perspective is and what my perspective is, although we still fundamentally disagree.
I don't want to cut you off, but I want to say that this expression that I have now is not an expression of a politician. It's not me. I'm not a politician. I'm literally somebody that is an activist and somebody that thought, you know what?
But that's what a politician will say, though.
No.
It is. You are employed as a politician. So am I.
Politicians talk a narrative. I don't have a narrative. I'm speaking purely because I do not want my children and their children and my cousins and their children to be barred from opportunities that belong to them. That is why I'm here. I'm not a politician. I joined politics only because I signed a membership form for the only party that spoke what I wanted to speak about, what I was about, which is the EFF, in when I was 30. So I'm not a politician.
We both are, though.
No, we you are. I'm not. I'm an
activist. Oh, wow. Okay. I'm
an activist.
I'll bring this up next time we're in council. And you've got to vote as a politician.
Go away.
But listen, maybe we can help that vote. But anyway, okay, let's get to the last point, right? So what I want to ask you is, do you think that a black individual can be racist?
No.
How? Okay, let me have a go at this first, right? Let me have a go. But wait, no.
Racism.
Okay, racism is when you stereotype a racial group based on certain characteristics, no. Or you wait. Or you insult them and think that everybody is like that, right?
No.
You're going to use the argument about how you need to have power in order to be racist first. So the thing is, right? Okay, hear me out, because let me have my say. I think that that saying that black people can't be racist is honestly one of the most insulting things you can say for a black individual, because that means that they don't have equal rights as in being a human being with feelings and expressions that can be right or wrong, and in this instance wrong. So by telling me a black individual can't be racist, it's absolutely ludicrous, but I would like to hear you justify it.
You can't be racist as a black person, because first of all, you need to define
what racism is. Racism is a system. Just that. Yes, Ronaldo. Racism is a system. I cannot be racist because I am not superior to you in terms of the system. Therefore, I can when I know superiority. No, listen to me. When I expose to you, when I expose to you what privilege you have, when I expose to you what opportunities you have over me, when I expose to you, regardless of what government is in place right now, which is neither here nor there because they've been there for 24 years, apartheid has been there for hundreds of years. When I say to you, you, Ronaldo, have access to things that I do not have. When I expose to you how you treat me, there are white people that talk to me in a different sort of accent, and I have to accept that. There are white people that talk to me in a condescending manner. There are white people who bump into me because I'm not supposed to walk. You don't understand white privilege. And when we expose that, we are called racist. When we say, look, I can't walk. I can't, as a black person, I cannot walk anyway. I cannot walk anyway without having to apologize for the fact that my skin is darker than yours. You don't have to. You walk into a place, you complain. You can't stand in a queue. You're at the bank. You moan. You call for the manager. Everything comes to you.
Such a generalized statement, because I've seen black individuals.
It's the truth, Ronaldo. Look, it's the truth.
This was something that Trevor Noah did as a wait now. This is something that Trevor Noah did as a skit, right? Where I remember a couple of years ago where black individuals would look at white people losing their shit in a queue, right? And I laughed at that because it's something I noticed. Back then, I actually never saw a black individual lose their shit like white people did in a queue or in a bank or like you said. But that has changed. Of course, I have seen many black people lose their shit when they're in the queue or when they're upset over something. Changed. Of course, I've seen it with my own eyes.
Honest. No. You know what? We need to do a skit. Actually, you need to bring me back and we do a flipping low life skit and I will show you.
Okay. But the thing, listen. Racism at its core is stereotyping. It's stereotyping.
Black people cannot be racist because black people are in the receiving end of racism.
So you're telling me
black people, there's no black person that is racist. Any black person that says anything against a white person, it is because they're trying to speak out against an injustice that is being done to them. There's no black person that is racist in this country, anywhere, even in America. Black people cannot be racist. You cannot be racist when you are not the oppressor, when you are not, you do not have power over people. White people have power over us, whether it be a psychological power, an economic power, whatever power, but they have power over us as we speak. How can I be racist over you, Ronaldo, when you have more power than I do?
Let me give you an example, all right? A severe example. To try and illustrate my point, right? Let's say a black billionaire from South Africa, right, goes into one of the few white.
Who's the black billionaire?
No, wait. I'm just using an example.
Who?
I'm giving you.
No black billionaire.
Okay, well, let's use Cyril Ramaphosa. He is a black billionaire. He is. He's literally a black billionaire. Okay. So Cyril Ramaphosa, as an example, not saying he is like that, goes into one of the few white townships that exist in this
Which country. Ones are
there? No, well, they are. They are there's a handful like, across this country. But you listen, I'm using an example.
There's no
right?
example. Here.
Okay. So, okay, let's
use another narrative, friend.
Let me use another narrative. Okay, so let's say Cyril Ramaphosa goes into a street where there's a white beggar. In Summer Strand, where there are white beggars, right? Okay. So, and he goes up to this white beggar's two-year-old son, right?
Because the white beggar's got a baby on him.
No. So then this this black billionaire goes to that two-year-old white beggar's son, and he goes to him, oh, look at this pink little piggy over here that is like so beautiful with his little blue eyes.
No, not do that, Ronaldo.
But I'm saying, you said there's no black billionaire. So now what you're saying is that black billionaire...
No, would not say it. There's a little... That's just how it is.
Okay, but I'm using a black billionaire because you're saying that there are no black racists. And I'm trying to tell you...
No black person can be a racist. That is a truth.
That is such a ludicrous mindset.
It's not. It is.
That is like a free ticket to...
You need to accept it. When I differ with you based on your privilege, that does not mean
that's
I'm
my
racist.
Privilege. What? I'm not talking about you. I'm just saying that...
Privilege.
No ways. I'm just saying that... I'm sorry, like it's actually hurting my brain to the fact that black people can't be racist.
Even your example right now that you tried to use is like, I can't get it. Like,
yeah, but I did. I tried to make a severe example to just maybe get the
doesn't
fact
that... doesn't make sense because black people cannot be racist. We cannot be racist. We're not racist as black people. You cannot be racist as an oppressed people because racism is what informed apartheid. Racism is why we are where we are. Racism is a system that still exists now, where when you walk into ShopRite, you don't even go to ShopRite, you go to Pick and Pay, and you think you cannot stand in a queue for longer than 10 minutes. Because really, why should you? It's a privilege. And when you see another person a darker skin than you, it offends you. When you are in Walmart Park, you can't even stand the fact that there's so many, why so many black people? Why?
No, but you can't, that's a generalized statement. Maybe there are people like that, maybe there are, and I'm sure there are.
You don't live my existence. The thing is that you don't live a black existence. That's why you
I get that, but not every single white person that walks into Walmart Park, which is a shopping center in Port Elizabeth, for those of you that don't
know. We need to go underground. And you need to see. Either as
how do I do that though? I don't want to do a black. I don't want to do a black face because
I'm not going to do a black face. But you need to go underground as a black person.
That's like a Leon Schuster vibe.
Even through me. But you can go do that, and you can see how white people even treat me, a person that speaks almost like they do, which is most acceptable to white people and condescending to myself, because I always think like, why should I have to accommodate you for you to accept what I'm saying, even to buy a newspaper, even to do anything? It's uncomfortable.
I get that. I get the accent argument. It's something that pisses me off too. I can't deny you on that. But listen, when we do this undercover stuff, when we do this,
when we do this
undercover thing, right? Are we gonna at least go in your car because you got a nicer car than what I do?
I don't have a nicer car. Which car do I have?
Well, I'm not gonna mention it. Yeah, do you want to like?
I have a Nissan NP200, and you have a nicer car than me.
No ways, I don't. Yes. I drive a VW Polo. What are you talking about?
Better car than mine.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, listen, okay, I think we had a good go at it. We've been on NR for 80 minutes. Look, I think there are people that are quite shocked with what you said. I have to say that there's a couple of things that I fundamentally disagree with you on too. I think we missed the definition of what racism is. Racism's got nothing to do with power. Racism's got everything to do with prejudice and a set of... Listen, before we end, let me read you the definition of racism, just so we're both on the same track, right?
Fine.
Racism is a prejudice, discrimination, or antagonism directed against someone of a different race based on the belief that one's own race is superior.
That's what I said.
So you want to tell me that there's no black person in South Africa that think that they are superior than a white person?
No, because ultimately we are on the receiving end. We are
getting
to the when someone treats you, it's like you feel poor, whether you're white or you're black. When you are poor, when there's a poor member in your family, you treat that person automatically. Automatically, that person is not the equal to everybody.
and that person gets the last of everything. That person, you, your children give the least, the, those tracksuits from Pick and Pay that have little bits of dust in them, you give to the poor person because you don't see that person as equal to you, because you wouldn't wear those same pants, but you want to give those same pants to the same, to another human being. So that is what racism is, and that is what we've been faced with.
Isn't that being charitable though?
Black people cannot be racist. Black people are not racist. And I'm not going to go into a narrative because I don't articulate myself in a way that is woke or whatever or acceptable in terms of the space of what we're in now. But I'm telling you now, there's no black person that can be racist in South Africa or any way, for that matter, in the world. Black people are not racist. We are on the receiving end. We are the lowest of the low. We are the most oppressed. We are the wretched of the wretched. And we don't, nobody sees us. So how can we be racist? So when you speak against atrocities and things that happen to us, that means we're racist. No.
All right. Well, on that bombshell, I think that's where we
are,
should
there people,
end.
Are your people coming at me?
Listen, I think you need to go and watch this afterwards just to check.
I'm
how
not gonna watch that.
This comment section is woke, I'll tell you that. And it's definitely not in your favor. But hey, there's 150 people watching and they're giving their opinion. It's okay. Look, it's making us talk, which is something that's important. And it's better than sitting and staring at each other and not saying a word, right? Yeah. So even though I consider you a close friend. I think you are deep inside a great human being. But
why
when it comes
deep inside, I am a great human being.
No, I know. I'm saying deep inside your heart,
my
that
blackness.
Is so. Oh, God, you see, now you're putting words in my mouth.
Sorry.
I think that you are well, at least in council, at least you light up my day. And I think that you are a very kind person. I think that your political outlook is completely skewed and completely the opposite of what I believe. But then again, I think you feel the same way about me. So it's just one of those things. So listen, in closing, thank you very much for coming on the live stream. I have to say that this was woke, definitely. I'm not, are white people allowed to use that term or not?
It's okay.
Okay, so I get a pass
for
this
one.
You're
annoying. You're literally annoying.
All right.
You're so annoying.
But anyway, listen, thank you very much for being on the live stream. I appreciate it. Right. And to everybody still watching, please be sure to hit that like button. Please be sure to subscribe. And if you are subscribed, be sure to hit that bell icon so that you can be notified of my future upload. And then please be sure to tune in next week, Sunday, for the next Sunday debate. I'm not sure who will be on it, but you can follow me on Twitter and then you'll be notified there. And that's basically all I've got to say. So till later, cheers and peace out.